So yes, you can play the Bach partitas on an F5 mandolin, or at least an excerpt. This particular mandolin was made on February 18, 1924, and signed by Lloyd Loar on that date. My nickname for this one is Cleveland, which is a whole other story that I won't get into now, but it's an extraordinary instrument that plays both classical and bluegrass music. Now, the main reason we're even here today, talking about Lloyd Loar mandolins, is because of a man named Bill Monroe. What happened was, Gibson hired Lloyd Loar. He came to the factory. He devoted his time to building a better mandolin. He demanded great expertise and a quality of workmanship from the very fine old world craftsmen there at Gibson and Kalamazoo during that period. They produced a better mandolin. He also insisted on things like silver plating and an elevated pick guard. He nearly bankrupted Gibson. It was a time when the excitement about mandolin was over, and everybody had moved on to a different kind of music, and except for a few virtuosos like Dave Apollon, nobody was buying these F5s, so the Gibson Company was almost bankrupt. Something had to be done. In January of 1925, the board of directors called a meeting. Lloyd Loar showed up, brilliant as always, with his plans to save the company. He had drawn up schematics for the production of electric instruments. This is January 1925. This is 15 years before Rickenbacker and Fender, Leo Fender out in Fullerton, even thought about a magnetic coil pickup. Lloyd Loar was there with the whole thing on paper. He was ready to go into production. Electric bass was first, and then guitar, and then violin. The board of directors looked at the papers and looked at him and said, "You're fired." So they kicked him out, and they put their accountant, Guy Hart, as general manager. And Guy Hart, his first edict was, "We're going to build banjos." So all these mandolins, all these F5 mandolins that Loar had made were sitting on the shelves, and they were nowhere to go. So some of them were sold, some of them laid around the factory and were sold later. They trickled out eventually. They didn't reduce the price, that much we know. The prices have never really gone down on these things, quite the opposite. But what did happen was a lot of people who purchased them wound up losing interest, or maybe the orchestra they played in had disbanded, and the instruments wound up in the attics and the closets, and then they wound up in the pawn shops and the garage sales, as the people who inherit them don't really value them. So Bill Monroe, he and his brother Charlie started playing music in the 30s, and they were tearing it up pretty good and getting very popular with their style of music. And Bill Monroe, when they broke up, they had a big fight and broke some guitars over each other's heads and went their separate ways. And Bill Monroe decided he was going to start a great music with a great, really hot band, but he needed a better mandolin to do that. And so in right around 1943, 44, he walks into a barbershop in Florida, in Miami, Florida, and there sat a 1923 Lloyd Loar F5. And he played it. That was the mandolin. So today, we have a 1923 Lloyd Loar F5. This one was signed on April 25th of 1923. Yesterday was this mandolin's 90th birthday. Isn't that great? And so, Bill Monroe did not play Paganini Caprices. He played a very different sound. Cool. So this is the Monroe thing. You know, you've got to have a mandolin that's powerful and it can get up there with the voice. also the lonesome sound of Mill Monroe. You know, I was lucky enough as a young man thanks to my parents, to follow Bill around. They would carry me to wherever he was playing. And Bill always loved kids, you know. I've still got a couple of quarters he gave me. And the one thing that I noticed was his mandolin. Although he had gotten mad at Gibson, up here at the top it says the Gibson. He had gotten mad at Gibson because he had sent it back and he wanted new frets, but they refinished the mandolin and it came back. When you refinish an instrument, it loses its sound. It came back with no sound. So he pulls out his pocket knife, he scrapes off the new finish, and then he gouges Gibson out. So when I first saw this mandolin, all I saw was the stylized THE and the peg head. And I just put it, I was a bit of a trader at the time. I traded, anything I could, but especially pocket knives. I figured it was a tree grand mandolin, like the pocket knife. Boker made a tree grand pocket knife. I figured it's a tree. I went to every pawn shop in the country looking for a tree grand mandolin and never could find it. And it wasn't until we looked inside and saw the name Lloyd Lore that we realized there was something special about it. One time I had a mandolin. That was just like this one. It was an old overhaul, and it had belonged to Carl Davis of the Cumberland Ridge Runners. And I took it and showed it to Monroe, and it had Cumberland Ridge Runners written on the case. It's pretty obvious, and it was pretty beat up. And I did not realize that at the time, but the Cumberland Ridge Runners played on the WLS Barn Dance in Chicago in 1934. And Bill and Charlie Monroe were up in Chicago working for Sinclair Oil. They were barrel rollers. And they had their first music or their first entertainment gig as dancers on WLS Barn Show. And Cumberland Ridge Runners were the band that played for Bill and Charlie and their girlfriends to dance to. And so I show up, I'm just a 15-year-old kid. I show up with this mandolin, and Bill recognizes it. And, he brings me into the dressing room, and we're playing it. And I had just learned, he had just come out with an album that had a song called Dusty Miller on it. And I had learned that right off the album, and I had learned it just like I'd slowed the record down, the vinyl record. I slowed it down and learned that note for note, just like Bill had played it. And Bill sees the mandolin. He's really not saying a lot, and I had no idea he already knew this mandolin very well. And so he says, "Will you play me a tune on that thing?" And so, I guess I was a little cocky in those days. I'm glad I mellowed out of that. But I pulled it out and I played exactly what I had heard on that record. It sounded kind of like this. But he takes out his F5 and he starts playing that same song, but he played it like this. Thank you. says, I think that's how that song goes. I was completely just horrified. I mean, I knew something was wrong. I had learned it wrong, obviously. I spent so much time, and I completely learned the song. So all that night, you know, my dad had the campsite set up and everything. All that night, I sat by the campfire and worked on that. You know, trying to get that real lonesome. And I realized that you really had to have an F5 to really do that right. So the next morning, Bill hit the main stage. And I was right there in the wing so I could see really closely, which was pretty normal for me back in those days. And he had Kenny Baker and Joe Stewart was playing guitar. It was a classic band, you know. And I was standing there. And about halfway through the show, Bill says, well, one thing I'm going to tell you is a lot of people ask me if Bill knew me well enough to call me by name. And I said, of course he did. I'm Hey Boy. So, you know, about halfway through the show, he said, and there's a young man over here that's going to come up and play mandolin with me. Hey Boy, you come on out here. And I'm looking around to see who Hey Boy was. And then somebody just pushed me out on the stage, and I walk up there with my mandolin, and Bill has the old F5, and Bill looks at me and says, we're going to do the Dusty Miller, you kick it off. Okay, so I step up to the microphone, and I start playing it just like he had showed me in the dressing room. And Bill came in right beside me, going... So, something happened to me that day. I understood that two mandolins could play together, you know, not necessarily in the kind of harmony that we think of, where we kind of move parallel to one another, but where you have two different things in counterpoint moving together, and it was really quite beautiful. So I'm going to try to play a little bit of Dusty Miller now and see if I can interweave those two styles. Thank you. Another great thing about the F5 is that, you know, Bill Monroe brought it out of obscurity. And then suddenly, a lot of people started understanding that the F5 was really cool, and we wanted to have one. Gibson still made the F5 back in those days, but they weren't very good. 1960s and 70s F5s, pretty well, forget about it, you know, just not a lot of sound. So you were trying to find an old one. And so it made itself available as we would find them, you know, out where we could. You know, a lot of times, you know, people ask me where I get these mandolins, you know, I work very hard at it. But a lot of times there are, you know, estate sales where the, you know, older people have passed on and you can find these things. And so they entered into other types of music other than bluegrass. And another one of my great heroes was the great Jethro Burns.
Yeah.
And he often made fun of me. He says, you know, things like, problem with you boys, you still playing antique mandolins. And the other one was, the reason I play such a crappy mandolin is so that if somebody likes what I do, they know it's me and not the mandolin. But I let him play my Lloyd Lore one time, and I was just marveled, and it sounded something kind of like this, I don't know.
Woo!
This is a March 31st, 1924, Lloyd Lord that was originally sold to the Baltimore Mandolin Orchestra, a man named Conrad Giebler originally owned this one, and it's been with me for 36 years now.
What's the name of the tuning fork?
That was Cherokee. That's actually my arrangement. It's one I recorded on David Grisman's Tone Poets album. So that was, it was inspired by Jethro, but that's really my arrangement.